like pasty white. Can you imagine being in the water and having wet boots for days on end? Gangrene will eventually set in, and parts of your feet just start falling off, whole chunks, because of the gangrene.
Nice.
Yeah, it's lovely. You guys hungry? One of the things that they had to do is they had to check the soldiers' feet to make sure that they didn't have the gangrene starting to set in, or wounds. If you cut your foot and your foot stays wet, you know that you're going to end up with bacteria in there and an infection. This is just gangrene. That's what trench foot is. It's just that moist condition. Ew. That's what my daughter's feet look like when she's finished with soccer. Nope, doesn't work. This is just too much fun. They're living quarters. They're living on top of each other in many cases. There's lots of men shoved in these tiny little spaces. I mean, these guys are sleeping on top of each other. You can't get good sleep. It's stressful. You're waiting for the next mortar round to come in and hit you, or the mustard gas to hit you, and it's stressful. They are not able to take the dead out as quickly as you would hope, and so you're fighting on top of the dead. And in many cases, they're left there for a significant amount of time. This is a skeletonized victim. He's British, I guess British. In the trench that was left there long enough to be skeletonized. And of course, they've got the mice that are, and the rats that are eating them. That helps. But that tells you how long that body has been left there. Okay, another group. There is a constant threat of bombardment. Constant threat that another battle is going to start. Constant threat that you're going to be hit by gas. Constant threat. And so that stress works against your body. PTSD, that type of thing. There is also always the threat of a gas attack. And they outfitted everybody with gas masks. Dogs, horses, you know, whatever was breathing.
Except mice.
Yo, God, kill the mice. Let's use mustard gas on mice.
Pretty effective.
Unless you get touched by it. The Germans are going to use gas. They're not the first. But they're going to be the first to use gas to kill people. In the beginning, the French were using almost like a tear gas, a chemical almost like mace, as an irritant. It wasn't meant to kill. What the Germans do, yeah, you're laughing at my horse picture, aren't you? What the Germans do is they are attempting to kill people using gas. They're using things like chlorine gas, first used at the Battle of Ypres. By the way, the British call Ypres because of the spelling. I don't know, do I have the spelling up there? No, I don't. It's Y-P-R-E-S, looks like wipers. They call the battle of the town, the Battle of Wipers. They use mustard gas, and it's not made from mustard, by the way. No mustard seeds involved. It is a yellowish, greenish plume that is created when it's dropped, so that's why it's called mustard gas. They both use this, both sides. So the Germans aren't the only one. Germans are the first ones, though, to use deadly stuff. They go through all types of versions of the gas mask. It's kind of neat to see how it develops, that technology develops. But like as you can see, the dogs are being masked, the people are being masked. This is actually an Allied attack. The British drop this gas. Now, if I'm dropping gas, what is the biggest issue? If I'm
wind direction.
Yes, it's dangerous to use this. It is not very effective. But it's terrifying. The whole idea of suffocating. And by the way, if you are in a trench and they've dropped mustard gas in the past, you can get pockets of it in the water. When you step into that water, you're dead. So that's more stress. Yeah,
walking on a minefield, sure.
Yeah, it is. It's a gas minefield.
People are just putting logs down there so you had something to walk on that would.
But that would pop your head above the thing. You're down below the water table. Yeah, you don't want your head sticking up. And it's tough. Now, shell shock, and I had a video, and I can't get it to pull up. Click on it when you get a chance. It shows you the various manifestations of this disorder. Shell shock is what they titled PTSD. It is well known to have that, what they call the 1,000-mile or 1,000-yard stare or the 1,000-foot stare, whatever they call it. you'll see it out of the way, thousand yard stare. It's this kind of like glazed over look that many of the soldiers had. And this is the picture you always see. This is an Australian soldier who's like in La La Land. There are some different beliefs and some different research that's come out recently about what exactly shell shock was. Because it gets its name, of course, because, you know, shell, you know, like a bomb going off. But then there's these types of reactions and what I had on the clip type of reaction where there's tremors and uncontrollable body movements, uncontrollable flicking of the eyes. And at the time, they didn't have the science to be able to go through and research this the way that we would do it today. There is the belief now that there are two or three different types of shell shock. One is from the stress and battle fatigue. One is from like the concussive effects of multiple shells going off near you. And it doesn't have to be close to you. It has to be close enough to where you can get the concussive force of that bomb going off and the damage that goes on in the brains. And so they've gone back and they've studied the behaviors and things like that. Plus the like the NFL with the concussion surveys or the concussion research that they're doing, they're coming into a deeper understanding of what this exactly was. Look at that video that won't pull up on my thing because it's pissing me off. Yeah, it won't pull up. See, it's gonna like, right now it's telling me that it has to contact the server for more information. Let's cancel that. I don't know what's going on. It worked for my house. It did not work for me, I think it's better. Okay, so you have a breakdown by year. If you are chronological and you can't stand to look at a war by theater, look at this. What I do is I've got like a map in here. This goes through the overview of each year. You can see what's going on each front. I am going to cover next week. I'm going to go through and say, okay, here's what's going on in the West, which isn't much because they're digging in. Here's what's going on in Russia. We're going to spend a little bit of time talking about the Russian Revolution. Here's what's going on with the Ottomans. I'm very quickly working our way through this. Does that make sense? If this helps you, use it. That's the only, I'm not going to go through this because this doesn't help me. And I'm not going to go through that way. It doesn't help. But if it does help you keep things straight, look at that. There's like three or four slides on there. Take a look at the next slides that are coming up because I'm going to be throwing a lot of stuff about Russia at you. See the big smile? If there is anybody, okay, you still need one to take the test real quick. If you did not get